Good afternoon. We're excited to begin this next session here for the high school conference at the Reagan Ranch and the Wendy P. McCaw Roundtable Luncheon. It's my privilege today to introduce our guest speaker. Ron talked a little bit about his accomplishments, but they are so many that I'd like to run through a few more for you today. His work is noteworthy and highly expansive, making his commentary one of the most thorough and precise in the conservative movement today. Mr. Steinberg is a prominent strategist, analyst, and a renowned pollster. He became involved in the 1964 Barry Goldwater campaign, enrolling at UCLA, where he began writing for YAF Publications and the UCLA Bruin. He attributes the Goldwater campaign to jumpstarting his experience in public policy because of its unique blend of philosophical motivation and activism. He also became a Youth for Reagan volunteer while at UCLA. Later, he transferred to George Washington University, where he experienced the intensity of the left firsthand after becoming the editor of YAF's New Guard publication, a publication that continues on our website today. As the editor of New Guard, he introduced a regular column called The Radical, written by David Friedman, Milton Friedman's son. He was also an award-winning debate team captain, debating major leftist figures, including the founder of the Students for a Democratic Society and communist youth leaders. In the 1970s, Steinberg served our country in the California and DC National Guard. He was the first person, as Ron mentioned, hired in 1970 by the Jim Buckley campaign. His successful senatorial run in New York as press secretary and second in command for day-to-day operations. And prior to this, those of you from Wisconsin might be interested to note that he had worked on David Keene's state senatorial race in Wisconsin. Since this early involvement, he's gone on to provide strategic counsel and excellent quantitative data for nearly 2,000 public policy and philanthropic research projects and focus groups, often getting his predictions right when typical political pollsters failed miserably. His cutting-edge sampling, novel methodology, and original questionnaire formats became industry standard. Here in California, he was a critical factor in the campaign for Californians Prop 209 to prohibit racial and gender preferences. Also, as an adjunct professor, Steinberg taught a four-unit graduate-level course at Pepperdine University. President George W. Bush appointed him and twice reappointed him to the Board of Visitors for the National Defense University. He has served on numerous other government commissions and foundation boards throughout the years. Today, we're going to hear about his memoir, Whiplash, From JFK to Donald Trump, A Political Odyssey. The American Spectator said this about the book. If you want to understand how a new political movement came from terra incognita to dominate American politics by the 1980s, read Arnold Steinberg's amazing and exciting political odyssey, Whiplash. Yes, Buckley, Goldwater, and Reagan were important and absolutely essential, but it took the labors of hundreds of citizen soldiers to succeed in such an enormous accomplishment. Steinberg was and is one of the most important of these dedicated conservatives, and he has quite a story to tell. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to introduce Arnold Steinberg so we can hear his story. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. You know, I feel like I got two introductions today. The first was Ron, and I'm very fortunate to have a second one, which was just as nice. You know, sitting at the table here with some of the people here, I felt like I was going to skip my speech and just talk to all of them and listen to all of their stories. But looking at the weather here in Santa Barbara, I remember that campaign in Wisconsin in November, December for David Keene and Ford Atkinson that had all about 7,000 or 8,000 people. And with Ron reminds me of the old days in Buffalo. And once elected to the Senate, when Jim Buckley, I'd go to Buffalo several times a year. And at least once a year, find myself stranded for two or three days there in a snowstorm. So those of you who are facing all the liberals here in Santa Barbara don't know what the nature really is like in a tough campaign. I share Ron's feeling of grief with the DeVos passing, and last weekend at the Philadelphia Society, a conservative group, Eric Prince was there, who's also related there, the Navy SEAL who founded Blackwater. I wanted to say a moment about Scott Walker in Wisconsin. Is one of the points I make in my book, and it repeatedly talks about, and this is part of my theme today, about what happened in the 1960s and how it relates to today, is that we didn't have public government unions in this country until JFK at the national level, and here in California, Jerry Brown. And the reason why was a recognition of what we as conservatives know to be the case, which is government involves a level of coercion. We give to government some level of power in order to provide for us some level of order within which we can function a free society. So the idea is that if you work for the government, you're working for a situation where we have no choice, and it's unlike a free market situation. And so what Governor Walker has done in Wisconsin is really taken the national stage in providing leadership to try to redress that. And our liberal and progressive friends who claim to be so concerned about the downtrodden and the poor have put together a system of entitlements and pensions for public or government employees that are going to really starve the so-called public sector, and those people will be the most hurt. So I would just like to say I've never had the pleasure of meeting Governor Walker, but I am deeply in admiration of your husband and his courage, and I wish others in, around the country would follow that model. You know, I... heard Ron talk about the old days, and he said something I was going to talk about later on in my remarks. But, you know, those of you who are here who are in high school, he talked about making choices and so on. But it's more than that. Let me tell you that when I was your age, I could never imagine this year in which I am here ever occurring. It seemed so preposterously and inordinately into the future. And I remember seeing a movie called 2001, A Space Odyssey. And that's because 2001 was very, very far away. What Ron's talk reminds me of, and this is what is really, really amazing and will be very, very difficult for you to grasp, is that I can go almost anywhere in the United States and run into somebody that I knew and worked with in the movement of young Americans for freedom. Now, I don't see Ron very often, but there's a kinship there that grew out of those years that mysteriously prevails and continues among a whole group, not just the three or four or five people, but dozens. It could even be 100 or 200 people. I will sometimes be in a city and run into somebody, and I never recall meeting them, but they recall meeting me, being part of something. So when you think about where you are today and who you are with, as inconceivable it is to think of the very distant future, think about how envious people will be of you years later when you can have so many friends for such a long period of time. And the reason you will have them is not because they're of a particular gender or a particular race or a particular level of affluence, but because you share with them some kind of values that that bind you for that period of time, which takes me into, I have given a lot of talks over many years, and I've almost never written a speech and usually have sparse notes or no notes. But the reason I wrote remarks for this is the same reason I wrote the book, is that I thought about when I was your age, and I could barely relate to World War II. I was a boy growing up in the 1950s and the 1960s. But, you know, my dad spoke to me, and there was some relationship there. But occasionally people would make reference to World War I. Now, that was really ancient, and I never quite got into that history. But I thought about writing my book, and I thought about being here today, and, you know, when I talk about the 60s, it's as far away from today as World War I was for me when I was in high school. So as relevant as it seems to me and to Ron, it must seem really weird to you. And I hope it will be less weird after we talk and look at some of the parallels. You know, more than two millennia ago, the great sage Hillel had said, "If I am not for myself, who will be for me? But if I am only for myself, what am I?" And that really is what American conservatism is about. One founder of Young Americans for Freedom at Sharon, Connecticut, once got so tired of all the hyphenated conservatives, neoconservatives and traditional conservatives and libertarian conservatives and paleo conservatives and fusionist conservatives and Trump conservatives, he just said, you know, I'm an individualist. And the spiritual part is really the individualist is part of an organic whole, and that's the way we conservatives see it. You know, we open with the prayer and we open with that. And it's not because we're chauvinistic or nationalistic. It's because there's a kind of a sense of community that one of the great conservative icons, Alexis de Tocqueville, a Frenchman who came, and he came to America because as a European 150 years ago, he couldn't quite figure out why could people so different come here and have this kind of sense of community there. And that's really what we're talking about. We're trying to find things that bind us together rather than divide us. And if we have some protest we have to make, we make it within those parameters of that kind of spirit of unity and a sense of community that's far more powerful than government, and it's missing. And I was speaking to Ron earlier, and I asked Ron to look at some of the remarks he was going to make, and I said, do you think that that these are okay? Because we have all these high school students, and we have a lot of people from a different generation. And one of the things I wanted to mention is that Alexis de Tocqueville came here, and he wrote Democracy in America, which is a great classic of conservatism, but when he came here, it was to study incarceration in the United States. He couldn't understand why it was that Europe had so many people in prisons and we didn't. And after being here a while, he wrote Democracy in America because he wanted to explain to the world how it is that we have the sense of community. But he said in his book that America's decline will come when we change what I see. And we have changed that. And so when you see these people on campuses of the left who keep talking about mass incarceration, all these things, you know who has moved ahead in criminal justice reform? It's people like my old friend Mitch Daniels, the governor, former governor of Indiana. It's people like Ronald Reagan's confidant and counselor and former attorney general, Ed Meese, because we as conservatives believe in order to provide liberty, but only a limited amount of order, just enough so free men and free women can survive. We don't believe in inventing crimes and creating crimes and so many laws that you don't even know if you're breaking a law and draconian penalties and all of that there. And, you know, when you look at the religious basis of crime and punishment, law and order, it's restorative justice that has worked in the past and still works now. And when you see, for example, the effect of some of the ministry in prisons there, that's how you deal with revolving door recidivism there. Now, why is that issue important to you? It's important to you because when you're in high school and you go into college there, you're going to find that you want to communicate with people who don't believe as you do. And the way to do that is to come out with some of the issues that concern them. You know, the war on drugs and putting people away for 20 or 25 years for using marijuana, that's not conservative there. It's really partly of the other side, and it's conservatives that want to reform that. The difference is that conservatives believe you ought to be free to do certain things, but that doesn't mean you ought to do those things there. And that's a very, very real difference. You know, time and again, the other side gets credit for what we do. Ted Kennedy got the credit for airline deregulation. Now, let me tell you, when I was from California, I used to go back and forth sometimes. I went to school in Washington after UCLA. And I've been to Washington 3 times in the last month. I normally don't go that often. And I was paying the same airfare I paid 50 years ago in the 1960s. When you adjust for inflation in real dollars, it's about an 80% decline there. Now, who put that together? It's all libertarian and conservative economists there. You talk to these people on campus and your students, and you people here are not going to be facing a draft that used to exist there. The left didn't do that. It's conservative economists and Milton Friedman, all those people put together. When I worked as a young man for Jim Buckley, I wrote that amendment that is effectively ended the draft, that 20-month extension when they didn't know what was going to do there. Now, I say that not because I'm important. What I did was important. Somebody else would have done it if I didn't. It's that the left has expropriated that idea. We don't get credit for things that we can do, some of which can relate to young people. Let me say something else that's very important that keys to what Ron said earlier. You know, there was a Ronald Reagan advisor named Edward Banfield, who's kind of a political scientist and a socialist. And Banfield said about class, he said, it doesn't have to do with breeding, it doesn't have to do with how you put your fork, what kind of wine you drink, or how you dress, or how you groom yourself. It has to do with orientation. And an upper class person is someone with future orientation, and a lower class person is somebody for instant gratification. Now think about that for a minute. What that means is that, you know, if you're the son of a billionaire and you're into to drugs, you're an alcoholic and so on, Banfield said it doesn't matter how much money you have, you're low class. And if you're the daughter of an immigrant who is has goals for the future and is striving to get educated, you're upper class there. And so, you know, when you look at some of the students who are here and your colleagues there, you're making a statement about the future and that you care about the future, and that's what defines you in a self-fulfilling prophecy as upper class there. And that's very, very important because, you know, when you look at people, Ron, you know, alluded to Weinstein, here's a guy with lots of money, lots of influence, lots of power there, but he's low class there. It doesn't matter how nice a hotel he stays in. It doesn't matter how much money he makes off of a movie there. He's low class there. And so when you look around at some of your fellow students, take heart. It doesn't matter what station in life you come from, what the background is of your parents there. You're making the kind of a statement that Ron suggested for your future. And even some of the people who disagree with us, at least if they're looking toward their future, I would give them that, although try to educate them a little bit about where they ought to be. Let me say a little bit more about conservatism, because we're going to talk about that, because one of the themes of my book, and it makes me sad, is that we sort of come full circle and are kind of back to the future, and it pains me in one sense that you have to fight the same battles we fought. And at the same time, I envy you because there's a lot of fun and excitement in the fight there. That certainly was the case for me. You know, when you look around at some of the people here, there are going to be some of these high school students who one day will be a member of Congress or will be a federal appellate judge. And when you look at some of the people here that Ron acknowledged as supporting these activities here, let me tell you that, you know, when I've had the good fortune in a number of projects over the years to spend time with people of enormous wealth, people that were billionaires, and in some cases mega billionaires, John Walton, who's passed away, the son of Sam Walton, the founder of Walmart, and he wasn't self-made, maybe his father was, but the ones who were self-made, they didn't want to talk about their latest business coup. They wanted to talk about how they started from nothing and how the first years were wonderful for them, and they had that excitement. And those who were supporting an organization like this were looking at it in some cases from a business standpoint. That is, they were looking at investing in people who are young and what payoff that investment would have. And one of the interesting things is that this, in a sense, is an elitist approach. Elitist not in a bad pejorative sense, like somebody is better than somebody else, but what you're saying is, you know something? If only one or two of you hits a home run, that's a wonderful payoff because you can affect and change history. And I will tell you that when I was at UCLA, William F. Buckley Jr. came to speak. I was very, very excited. And then he said, well, I want to spend some time with some of the conservatives on campus. So all six of us, we met with him. And, you know, on the platform, up there speaking, he had this kind of standoffish, this immense vocabulary and this erudite manner. It was terribly intimidating. And here he was spending time. And then I thought to myself, now, why is he spending time? And it was because he really wanted to hear what we had to say, and he wanted to cheer us up in this hostile environment. Now, why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this because at the time this was happening, in 1965, 1966, I couldn't possibly have imagined that 4 years later I would help elect his brother to the United States Senate. If somebody had told me that, I would have wondered what they were smoking. And in those years, they too were smoking. And when it was mentioned that I was involved in Youth for Goldwater, from afar, I mean, you know, when a candidate's running for president, you're kind of over there and you're lucky if you get up there. And I couldn't have imagined I would have the chance to meet and spend some time with Barry Goldwater a few years later, get to know his son. the reason I tell you this is that the story is not about me, it's about you, because there is in America still upward mobility. That's especially the case in politics, and it's really the case in the American conservative movement there. I have seen so many people, so many colleagues who've gone from one thing at 16 or 17 or 18, and 3 or 4 years later, they're on Capitol Hill working in a major position there. I was at the White House a few weeks ago, and there was a young man working there, and he was 25. He looked about 16. And he had a position of responsibility there. Now, he didn't get there through connections. He got there through hard work. The point I'm trying to make is that you have no idea how you can possibly influence history there. You can't anticipate the future, but you're in the right place, and there are people who are willing to invest because they know that if some of you turn out to be duds, and probably none of you will there, that... you only need one or two people there. How can you quantify the worth of a Gorsuch in the U.S. Supreme Court? How can you quantify some of the 140 pending or soon to be pending nominations for federal judge and federal appellate judge there? Any one of those people can make a decision that could profoundly shape this nation for the next century there. This is what we're dealing with. And so all too often, you know, the emphasis is on a particular election. But all we're doing, and I say this as somebody who's been involved in hundreds of political campaigns, is plugging the dam, the hole in the dam. It's a holding action. At the end of the day, what really counts is you know, the great conservative philosopher Richard Reaver said, ideas have consequences. And so unless you have something in your soul and your spirit, an idea of where you are and where you're going, all politics is an adrenaline-pushing rush there. And any of you, even at a young age, who know have been involved in the campaign, knows that even when you win, the day after the election, you go into almost a depression because you've gone from doing something 100 hours a week and you're suddenly sitting there, and it's like zooming at high speed and then coming to a stop and just sitting there not knowing where to go. So your real satisfaction is policy and ideas. Now, some people never discover that, and when you go to Washington Capitol Hill, you'll find they're there all the time, and they become part of the swamp. And my old friend Stan Evans, who passed away, said, you know, that's the problem with some conservatives. They start out thinking they want to drain the swamp, and by the time they get to Capitol Hill and they get there, they think it's a hot tub. So we conservatives, it's said, and it's very hard for somebody younger to accept this, but you'll go a lot farther if you accept it now instead of waiting, that we stand on the shoulders of those who came before us. And it's sort of a more eloquent way of saying don't reinvent the wheel. Now, I told Ron I'd talk a little about Milton Friedman, who I had the privilege of knowing. Milton Friedman is arguably the greatest economist of the last century. Milton Friedman was somebody who pioneered in the most sophisticated econometric, mathematical, economic models, and yet he could explain economics in simple terms to anybody, and he did. Now, he was 5 feet tall, but his stature was absolutely immeasurable there. And when he walked into a room and started talking, everybody stopped. And if you go to YouTube and you see the old interviews of him with liberals and Phil Donahue and so on, you will see how this 5 foot man, 5 foot tall man had metaphorically wonderfully broad shoulders upon which to stand. And I use Milton Friedman as an example because I'll tell you a little story Ron and I were discussing is when I went to move to Washington there to get involved in the student movement and in those days we had violence. But you know, when you're young, you don't think about safety and you're bold. But whenever I had police protection on campus to speak, and we had some of the same situations there, I wasn't worried. I was proud. I thought it was a badge of honor that people were so worried about what I had to say, they wanted to silence me. And that's what you had today. You ought to be honored that they're so fearful what you have to say that they want a safe zone to protect themselves against you. Think about that. You know, are you so eloquent, so brilliant that they can't possibly let you open your mouth for fear of the damage to their psyche? So when I came back there, I was under the new guard. That was a time we had during that decade in this country 4,000 major incidents of violence and bombings during the 60s. And I once debated Kathleen Wilkerson, who at the end of the debate, we were walking out, and she said, if I thought I could get away with it, I would kill you. So I thought, well, maybe that's hyperbole. And then about a year later, a few months before the Buckley campaign, her father's townhouse blew up because two of her colleagues were making bombs. They got killed. She wasn't there. And those bombs were going to have nails, just like they do in the Middle East there, to go off at Fort Dix at a dance of soldiers there who had returned from Vietnam. So when you see the kind of violence today, there's nothing new. What's sad is that we're right back where we are. And what's sad is that in those days when they were trying to silence me, the left, the hard left, the new left, there were liberals who stood by for me. They said, well, we don't agree with him, but he ought to have the right to speak. Nowadays, we don't see much of that at all. We see something called hate speech, this Orwellian concept that somebody can get into your head, and once they do that, they can define as hateful that which they object to. And so that's a very real discouraging difference between that. You know, when I started out as a precocious 12-year-old and was for JFK, John F. Kennedy, and I later found out that what drew me to him was what really would draw me to conservatives, because JFK was somebody who really believed in America, and he was for what we now call American exceptionalism there. And though I had a lot of differences with him and became disillusioned with him, I then began to realize that started me thinking toward what I really believed in. Because when we had the Bay of Pigs debacle, I sort of got to the conclusion of what I was against. I wasn't quite sure what I was for. And I started reading books like Capitalism Freedom by Milton Friedman. And that brings me back to what I was just talking about. So I moved back to Washington. And I tried to find a roommate, and I was going to some current events. There was the other young man, Bruce Weinrod. He was going to American University. I was going to George Washington. And he didn't have much money. I didn't have much money. And so we settled on an apartment for $125 a month, $62.50. And we made a mistake. We should have paid $135, but on a higher level. So when the Washington riots broke out, we had to evacuate from the ground floor. And anyway, a few months before, Bruce had gone to a meeting of the Philadelphia Society, a group that had been formed by Milton Friedman and William F. Buckley Jr., and a young graduate student named Ed Fulner, who went on to start and create and head the Heritage Foundation. And so Bruce, a few months before, the bright fellow, and he was invited to go to the Philadelphia Society, and they sent him something. And those were the days where, unlike some of the gracious people here who are supporting this organization, they didn't have a lot of financial support. They didn't have tuition and scholarships and people helping to have some of you here. And so Bruce said, well, I can't afford that. And they said, I'll tell you what, if you come and you kind of be a schlepper and you move stuff around and so on, you'll help us out with errands, you won't have to pay the fee. He said, okay. And then he scrambled to get the plane fare. And then he saw that there was you have to stay at a hotel a couple of nights. He said, I can't stay at a hotel. I mean, 2 days there, that's what I pay for rent for the whole month. And he said, I'll tell you what, the fellow said, I'll give you an address. Some people are going to put you up. And Bruce was very nervous of strangers and so on, but he wanted to go. And he took his address to show up. So do you know who were the host for Bruce, who had never met him in his entire life, putting up the stranger, was Rose Friedman and Milton Friedman, the Nobel winning comic. So there are a lot of points that are, first of all, you never know who you're going to meet. The second is that here was this, if you ever spent time with Milton Friedman, it was like being with a computer, except, he was had a personality. But you were dealing with someone at the sheer genius level. And here's somebody who had never met Bruce, taking somebody in because he cared about somebody who supposedly was bright and so on. And Bruce said to me that he spent hours with him. Now, this is a man who, in his day, as one of the great economists, could command a vast hourly fee to go before any corporate board in this country and grace them with his presence. So it gives you an idea that some of the people on whose shoulders you stand are not simply brilliant and accomplished and articulate and deep people, but nice people. And I've met a lot of those along the way, and I think that you will also. I'd like to talk about a few other points. You know, Milton Friedman was represented that ethos, you know, where you hear that saying, and I've heard it before, that there's no limit to what you can accomplish if you don't care who gets the credit. And it's very, very important. And it's been a collegial effort with Ron and many, many people there who were really not looking for vanity or recognition there. And that's how things come together. And the converse of that is also true. You're not going to accomplish very much if all you care about is getting the credit there. It's going to be very short-lived. And I think it's another lesson I learned along the way. Now, I do believe that there are a lot of things conservatives should get the credit for and we're not. I gave you an example of airline deregulation. I gave you an example of criminal justice reform, of the draft. And I'd like to talk to you for a moment about something that relates to people your age. We live in an age of Apple and iPhone and technology and the internet and social media and Facebook and all the rest. And you know, how many of your contemporaries know that the people who fought Uber and who fought Lyft and who fought Airbnb, they're the Democrats, they're the liberals, they're the people who oppose a free market. They're the people who the cab companies go to prevent Uber, the hotels go to prevent Airbnb. And the people on your high school campus and the kids in your college, they don't know that. And what you have to do is look for ways to communicate. You know, when I was around then and well before my time, the communists used to use single issues. They'd sit down and they'd say, now, we want to get new people, but we can't sell them on what we want to sell them with. So let's find one issue. Let's go to an African American. Now, of course, we've gone through all these nomenclatures. It was Negro, it was Black, African American, just like Mexican, Chicano, or whatever. But it doesn't matter what term you use to describe your race or ethnicity or religion. The communists compartmentalized. People were not individuals. They were all collective. They were all part of groups. And we have that now today far, far worse, this kind of group identity that's terribly divisive. And so they would go and try to appeal on some narrow ground to convert or reach somebody, and after having seduced that person on that single issue, sell them the whole ball of wax. And in a sense, that's kind of what you have to do in a more positive way, because what you have to sell is not totalitarian communism and collectivist state control. You've got something good to sell. But, you know, sometimes, especially in this day of philanthropic foundations that for the most part are not going our way, higher education that was lost a long time ago, and now high schools, public and private, that resemble the indoctrination that I had to wait for in college to get, is now starting a lot earlier. So in that kind of an environment, it's a tough road to hoe. So you have to find vehicles or vessels to communicate, whether it's Uber or Airbnb, and you have to make people understand that in the kind of collectivist society that they're going for, these things won't happen, or they won't happen as quickly. We would have had cell phones much earlier, except the Federal Communications Commission was screwing around with that stuff there. I mean, Wendy at my table will tell you that there. But how many people know that? So the more you get into the seemingly arcane world of economics, the more you find that you can find ways to communicate, and this is extremely, extremely important. You know, let's go back to Milton Friedman. You know, some of the people who deride him today, they say, well, you know, he was for open borders. But see, the difference is that Friedman was for, quote, open borders, but he was against welfare. He was against entitlements, because he was talking about the old days of America, where people came here to be part of America, not to have America change for them, but for them to change to become part of us. I know that, example of my mother came here 1929 from Poland, and she knew Hebrew and Yiddish and Russian and Polish and German, but she didn't know English. Now, she didn't expect somebody to accommodate her in any one of those languages there. She worked in the garment district, and she took a subway at night to go to school to learn civics and to learn about the Declaration of Independence and Abraham Lincoln and all of those things, probably even Christopher Columbus. So she was quite sacrilegious by current standards. And she never would have expected any sort of government benefits or entitlements or for people to start communicating in her language. So what we have today is not anything involving racism or ethnic superiority. It's precisely the opposite. We seek to be inclusive by having those kind of common denominators of community, of which saluting the flag is a symbolic gesture. We say whatever differences we have, whatever background, our race or our ethnicity or religion, that we can somehow come together. Now, the economic situation we face today is such a terrible repudiation of what we've already gone through. I keep using Milton Friedman as a vehicle because I remember him sitting down with me and telling me the same thing he told everybody else: we've won. The statist collectivist economies after World War II have been discredited, and he would go through country after country where state planning failed. And when he won the Nobel Prize, it was like our side intellectually has gotten there. But what do we see today? We see neo-Marxism. Well, they don't always use the term Marx, but that's what we see, the same sort of tired approach that we thought were discredited. So, you know, Ronald Reagan, one of his famous sayings is that we're never more than a generation away from losing freedom. And so, in effect, that battle now falls to your generation. In a sense, it ought not to, because we are reinventing the wheel there. But the stakes really are far higher, because we've come much further down that hill from what Reagan called that shining city in the hill, because we now have more teachers and more textbooks all eliminating some of the stuff that was inspirational and replacing it with this sort of American history is warped and there are all these problems. And one of your speakers that you have tonight and tomorrow is somebody who really knows about economics and knows that the government, you know, caused the Great Depression, causes economic instability and so on. But you're facing an uphill battle because you and your colleagues in high school and college are being inculcated, indoctrinated with facts that are wrong. You know, George Orwell had written 1984 in 1948, where he predicted a totalitarian society, and he was sort of the popular version of F.A. Hayek, that great philosopher. Ronald Reagan read The Road to Serfdom, it influenced him, where Hayek drew that connection between fascism and socialism and communism and all these kind of isms there that subordinated the individual to state control. And Hayek never accepted this sort of right-left terminology, nor did Ronald Reagan, who spoke about a scale of individual liberty there. And so those fascists are right over there with the communists on that end there, and we're on the other side. And that nomenclature gets very, very painful. But, you know, Orwell, in his book, he described the kind of totalitarian society that we still have, at least in North Korea, where Big Brother is Kim. There. And when we look at the challenges, in our day, it was communism and the Soviet Empire and its expansionism there. And whenever you're pessimistic or down, remember that I never knew a single person who thought the Soviet Union would fall in our lifetime. Not one. And I knew some people who were experts in the field. They all were taken by surprise. So, you know, when you least expect it, whatever the current version of the Berlin Wall might suddenly crumble in just a couple of days there. So that's a very, very important lesson. But, you know, Orwell talked about how the totalitarians control history. And if they control history, they control what's going to happen. Did you know that the term political correctness comes from communism in the 1930s. What happened is that a Stalin, who killed tens of millions of people, they took what was supposed to be the facts and they said, these are not facts. Whatever the party says, whatever the Communist Party says, that is reality. There is no other reality than what the Communist Party says. Now, that's about as anti-intellectual as you can get. I mean, how can people on a college campus support that kind of approach? And that's what they do today. Now, here's the kicker, is that there was actually a joke that was told back then, this is very serious, in the 1930s in the former Soviet Union. And it's two people talking, and one person said, but these facts are not correct. And the other communist said, but they are politically correct. Now, that's from the 1930s there. And think about those couple of sentences, how terribly revealing they are, because that's precisely what we're talking about today. So, you know, political correctness is anti-intellectual, as well as the fact that it's a shroud for devaluation of many traditional values. Now, you know, anybody, how many people read 1984? Anybody? Well, if you haven't, you ought to get it, because there's this wonderful scene in there where Winston, who thinks there's something wrong with this totalitarianism, and he's struggling with the idea that, you know, maybe he could have a relationship with a woman that is unapproved. He could think for himself. And he's being tortured. And the torturer, O'Brien, keeps talking to him. And he's trying to get Winston to advance. And Winston says, well, wait a minute. He says, is there a past? And he says, there is no past. We define the past. Where can you find the past? And Winston says, well, in books. We destroy the books. And then Winston finally says, well, in memories. And he said, well, no, we tell you what to remember. And he's going on and on, and Winston keeps resisting. He's getting more and more tortured. And he, after all the torture, he finally repeats what he's asked to repeat, which is, those who control the past control the present. And those who control the present control the past, and those who control the past control the future. And if you really think about it, it's incredibly meaningful, those words, because that's exactly what we're seeing today in this sort of rewriting of history constantly there. It's really an attempt to control the future there. How much time have we got, Ron? I don't know if I got. I want to leave time for questions.
1:30. Questions whenever you get a chance.
All right. So I'll just go a few more minutes. I'd like to talk about what the limits are of technology, because here we are in a high tech era, and you know, if you don't have some sense of morality or ethics. You know, there's no limit to what technology can be done for bad as well as for good. And so what you have to understand is it's not, you know, corny or traditionalist or retrogressive to talk about values. Because, with you know, if you go back and you look at Nazi Germany, Germany was an advanced Western country. It was not some weird place with a bunch of cranks. It had wonderful art and wonderful music and great physicians and scientists. But some of those scientists and some of those physicians, you know, were ethically challenged, and they were enlisted in terrible, terrible things. So, you know, when people say we have too complex a society to go back to the old ways, what they're really saying is that they are too lazy to try to adapt. And that's a lesson that's very, very important. The other thing you should remember is that when some people, you know, deride some traditional institutions, you know, go back and look sociologically at what happens when you have situations where very few people get married, where men abandon their children and so on. There, you do affect crime. You do affect other things. So those people who claim to be concerned about an efficient society and just things running very, very well, who simply ignore these sort of time-tested virtues, they're really contradicting themselves, tremendously. You know, there are so many other things that we could talk about, but I think what I'd like to do is take some questions. I can get to those points without looking down. We have some people with microphones here, and we can ask about literally anything, including current issues and what's happening in Washington.
Raise your hand and state where you're from and your name.
Hi, Hi, my name is Matthew Rosen, and I'm from Ojai, California. It's about 20 minutes that way.
Yeah.
And my question is...
Very conservative area. Just kidding.
You're telling me. So what caused after Reagan, you know, after you guys had to fight against communism, after that uphill battle, what caused us to fall right back down to Obama?
I think it's an excellent question about what caused us to fall back down. Now, David Horowitz, who was a very big on the New Left at the time I was on the other side, who later... you know, converted along with a lot of other people I knew, like the Philip Abbott Luce. David said, you know, what you often need is an enemy. So when you don't have that enemy, you know, Young Americans for Freedom had its greatest recruitment when there was something to be against and where there was a threat of SDS. But the second point that David said, which is I think almost far more important, is that you want very visible failure by the bad guys. And so when communism disappeared, you couldn't point and say, look at how screwed up they are there. And so people forget. I speak to many people in high school, and the idea of a former Soviet Union just seems so much in the distant past. And the other part of it is they can't relate to the sheer magnitude of misery and suffering there. You know, if somebody is murdered down the street, we'll all talk about it for weeks. It will be a big story in Santa Barbara. But when you talk about, 50, 60, 70, 80 million people being liquidated in the Soviet Union, Communist China, it's sort of like talking about the Holocaust. They're just numbers. And so in answer to your question, people cannot relate, nor are our history books coming alive with the sheer magnitude of human misery and suffering and deprivation and hunger and outright murder of massive numbers of people. So it's a distant memory, and so we wind up doing the same things all over again. And then finally, I think that people don't understand that socialism is merely the economic aspect of communism, and that's all it is. So I think we're doing those battles again, and there's a Milton Friedman in one of his pioneering works. Remember, this is a man who thought of things like school choice, barely tapping into his genius IQ. Every day there was another gem of a Milton Friedman idea, like school choice or how occupational licensure was most hurting people who are minorities and so on. And so Friedman explained clearly the relationship between political freedom and economic freedom. He said, how can you have one without the other? But what we have today is when communism fell, we have a kind of a rewriting of history as if it didn't exist at all, and we haven't learned from it. And there's a wonderful movie about the Eastern Police called The Stasi and the Lives of Others, if you haven't seen it. And this won an Academy Award, actually, not one of Harvey Weinstein's. And they actually took the old eavesdropping equipment that was used by... When you went to East Germany, East Germany had the highest incidence of people, not like us, but regular people, spying on their fellow citizens. In other words, if this were East Germany, one out of every four of you would be spying on the rest of you. And this movie showed the relationship between a playwright who was trying to pursue his artistry and the eavesdropping because he wasn't government improved. And I think the lesson is that you have to reach out to people in your high school and college who are into art, who are into music, who are into creativity, and they need to understand that the enemy today are the liberals and the progressives and the socialists there, because this political correctness is a precursor of an authoritarian system where art must conform to the government message.
Hi, I have a question for you. With your impressive background and your vast experience in political campaign management, I wanted to ask you if you would kindly address the issue of voter integrity, and then in a single party state like California, for those students who are from outside of California, where the top two candidates can be both Democrats, how do we re-enter or have the conservative voice heard? And you've managed a lot of campaigns, and this is a big issue in California, which, as you know, has filed to exit the union, if you will.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, my fellow conservatives outside of college would happily like to see that. You probably asked the worst possible question. Not that it's not a good question, but the one that's the most difficult to answer. I think there are some of my colleagues, how many people have read Atlas Shrugged? You know, there are some of my colleagues who kind of are looking for Atlas at California to shrug. And then in that total decadence and economic depression for a conservative Superman or Superwoman to arise from the ashes there. And we sort of tried that once with Arnold Schwarzenegger, and it didn't work. Schwarzenegger came in at a time when all the polls showed that people thought the state was in awful shape. And I talked to Democratic legislators at the time who feared his coming in and were ready to deal. And within 2 months, he basically gave away the store, partly because of his wife and partly because of his wanting to be like. So we lost that opportunity. We had in Meg Whitman what seemed to be, in this state, the candidate from central casting. We had a woman. We had a CEO. We had a self-funder whose net worth was over $1 billion. And we had somebody who wasn't from an oil company. They weren't from a polluter. They weren't from a tobacco company. They're from eBay, which typified the new age of high tech and had a wonderful image. And we couldn't win there because she couldn't do retail politics and relate. So time has been running out, and we now are in an incestuous situation where we have a combination of higher education, especially in this state, and the media. And then we have a situation where it used to be that in California, we have many offices, like in Santa Barbara, and you have a city council, county supervisors that are nonpartisan and party on the ballot there. So that used to be our hope for Republicans. But even that's proving more and more difficult because you have a situation where when you have all these people in the state Senate and state assembly and Congress in power, they're raising money and they're kind of incestuously helping all the others there. So I don't right now see a good prognosis, in California at all. And it was many Republicans, particularly, Warren Buffett's son, that put that money together for that so-called reform measure. And one of the things you guys in high school ought to realize, whenever you hear anything about political reform, it's the exact opposite. It means it's incumbent protection. So that would be the first step, and there may be a measure on to undo that situation where the two highest vote getters in a primary face each other in the general regardless of party. And by the way, one of the bad things about that is that it goes against third parties and fourth parties, which ought to be a concern for people into good government, and it cuts any leverage for possible Libertarian Party that at least on economic issues tends to be our way. As far as the opening question about voter integrity, this may shock some of you, but I'm not quite as worried about voter integrity as some are there. Well, first of all, most of the elections we're losing in California are by such an amount that it greatly exceeds whether there are some votes that of some dead people or so on. I still think that Chicago has the record for dead people voting. In my own research, I found a lot of the problems we had with the voter rolls were just, sloppiness and some people being registered twice. But in terms of their actual voting, I think the voter integrity problem is somewhat exaggerated. I know there are some people that are claiming in some counties the numbers don't match. I'm far more worried about the fact that we're just plain, losing elections by big numbers. And we used to have some loss leader issues that drew people in. In 1978, we had Proposition 13. That was a wonderful issue. And the trend in the past was you get an issue in June, and you candidate your position right, and then the momentum carries forward to November as opposed to having it on November. And we haven't had too many of those issues in the past, or they haven't been done well. So if we come up with some ballot measures, I would say this in conclusion. We have one possible development that may do well, which is the other side is so loaded with left-wing creeps that there may be positioning for very divisive primaries within the Democratic Party. And depending upon the math of some of those races or how many candidates run, it may be that in some districts, the candidate who wins in November, if it's still a marketable district where there's a Republican, they might have a candidate emerged so weak and so divided and so far left that we might be able to occasionally elect somebody. So that's one possible hope.
Your last question back here to your left.
Hi, I'm Mason Strand from Canyon High School.
Which high school?
Canyon High School. And I was wondering, how has the left been similar to communism and Marxism back in the day? And how have they been able to disguise Marxism to the point where it's widely supported among young Americans today?
Well, I think there's a series of good questions. First of all, you have said very briefly, because the question is so profound, we could discuss for a long time, is that the original Soviet-style communism, which many of us wrongly thought was kind of monolithic and spread everywhere, you know, became identified with Stalin, partly the way in which Kim is now in Korea, and you have this kind of liquidation. Where part of the downfall was they tried to take these different ethnic groups in Lithuanian, Estonian, kind of integrate them, and they even had a lot of Muslims in a part of the Soviet Union. So what happened in our day, in Ron Robinson's day, in my day, is they came up with something called the New Left. This was really a merchandising tool where you had Students for a Democratic Society, a nice sounding name, claiming they believed in participatory democracy, a sort of way to enfranchise people. So they were marketing what essentially was socialism as some sort of a democratic participatory way, ignoring the contradiction that, as Bill Buckley said, can you vote yourself into slavery? Can you vote yourself into a system where you can't vote yourself out? And they were able to gloss over that, and they were able to steal the thunder from our side, and they still are, in terms of a misconception of populism. Populism currently has come to be associated with a kind of a nativist, nationalistic, reactionary, angry spirit in the United States, when really the genesis of conservative populism is that we're the party of Main Street, not Wall Street. We're the party or the movement against crony capitalism, against using eminent domain to seize your property to benefit somebody else. We're against public-private partnerships that closely resemble the Mussolini corporate state, where every corporation, every company becomes an instrument of the state. And that's why you have attempted prosecution of a florist who, from a religious standpoint, doesn't endorse same-sex marriage, or Bakersfield same way, and in what you could only call involuntary servitude, is going to be compelled by the state, meaning the government, to perform a service against his or her conscience. It's because of the thesis that each corporation and each business is somehow an instrument of the state. So in answer to your question, I think that we've come since FDR and the use of the Interstate Commerce Clause to go beyond what our founders saw, which is that states ought not to erect trade barriers between states, to calling everything interstate commerce and using that as a rationale to control behavior, that whether the state owns something or not, which is socialism, we have the characteristics of socialism because we become state actors. We all become instruments of state policies determined by a group of politicians. And so I think that with all this intellectual confusion, they're able to sell a Marxian approach. And there are many facets to Marxism, but one of it is this whole idea that when you hear somebody say, well, what about the working people? Well, the idea is, you know, aren't there some physicians and lawyers and engineers and store owners who work for a living? Is it just that you have to belong to a union? And that whole nomenclature is an attempt to separate in this idea that they're the workers and those who exploit them. So with that as their starting point, everything else flows. And so the new left, I'm happy to say, did have some division, and there were some people who rejected Soviet communism, and they honestly thought they had something different. There were others who were just pretending, and there were old-style communists looking to market differently. So now we've gone from liberal to progressive, and progressive has become a euphemism for so much government power that it assumes the characteristics of socialism without the ownership. And one last point is, you know, when I was your age, I just assumed freedom of speech and freedom of religion and property rights and so on. That was part of what America was all about. And after a while, I thought, well, people on the other side have a different view than I of property rights. You know, they would say property rights or human rights. And of course, as Milton Friedman would say, well, who exercises property rights but humans? You know, you can't take certain rights and act as if they're not human beings involved. But nowadays, and what you face is something I never saw, which is that I never saw a serious sustained assault on freedom of speech and freedom of religion. Even liberals agreed with that. We might disagree on economics and rights of property, but they go and say, boy, those Nazis are awful, but they have a right to parade in Skokie, even if there's some Holocaust survivors who are going to face traumatic mental reaction. This is a free country, even if I don't like it. Now, they've gone the other way. So what your challenge is not only do we have companies and people that are supposed to be, in effect, actors in behalf of state action, whatever policy there. So you hear people talk about the First Amendment, you know, does somebody on a football team have the First Amendment to disrespect the other? Well, the First Amendment applies to government restricting you, you know, but, you know, try going to work here for a store in Santa Barbara and start mouthing insults and insults to people because of their race or their religion, and I think your employer would justifiably fire you. You don't have a First Amendment to do it. What you have is a First Amendment right that the government can't stop you from doing it. So this consensus has been deeply wounded in this country about basic rights, and I actually am very surprised that after all this time, and maybe not with so little appreciation of the Constitution and such a lack of understanding there, that we actually discuss to what extent you know, you can have universities keep people from talking at a place where, if ever there was a place where there should be dialogue, it would be universities there, and where we are discussing it in courts of this country, to what extent people's religious faith can be circumscribed or prohibited. Not because they're using their religious faith to do something horrendous, you know, where you have some sect and something there where people are sexually exploiting somebody or committing violence, like the Jonestown Massacre or something there, but people exhibiting the same kind of faith about certain things that have been accepted. So, you know, I don't regard all of these things as different than economics. I regard them all as related because, you know, if people talk about what's in your soul and say you have hate speech and it keeps being extended to what they don't like you say as hate speech, it's really an attempt to control what you think, because what you say is what you think. And, you know, we have somebody here who's a publisher of a newspaper. As Milton Friedman simply said a long time ago, you know, if the state controls the ink, there was no internet back then, but if the state controls the ink, they control what you can or cannot publish there. That's why it's all related. So, you know, when I was in the Soviet Union, you know, traveling, I met with artists there, and it became clear to me that they could not get their subsidy for their art or their painting or their music unless it conformed to the communist message, or certainly they couldn't do it if it was anti. And that is where we're headed right now in this country, sadly.
Arnie, thank you very much. I know there's a lifetime of experience, and that is hard to compact down, but you did an excellent job on each point. Greatly appreciated. For those who want the unabridged speech, we're going to have copies of his book in the Welcome Center right across the way. We greatly appreciate you being with us today and all that you've accomplished in your career. Thank you very much, Arnie. The students are going to the Reagan Ranch, so what we'd like, if you're capable, just waiting a few moments while the students make use of the facilities and then head onto the buses, and then we'll disperse as a general group after that. Thank you so much for being with us again today.